Hello and welcome to True Crime Garage. Wherever you are, whatever you are doing, thank you for listening. I'm your host, Nick, and stacked up beside me is a man that I have to remind once a week, you ain't gotta go home, but you can't stay here. The most fantastic captain of them all.
Thank you. It's good to be seen and it's good to see you.
It's good to see you, Captain. You got anybody that you like the jibby?
Yeah, we had our first garage sale, so I want to much love to everybody that came to the truecrimegarage.com and they went to the store and they bought a shirt and they'll be shipped out shortly.
Yeah, thank you. Much love. How about a beer, my friend?
Maybe you should stop peeing in the garage.
I'll pour the first one for you. This week, our beer of the week is Summer Solstice by Bob's of New Hampshire. Garage grade, we give it 3.5 bottle caps out of 5. This American Strong Ale is brought to us by some very good friends of the garage. We have Angela in Ottawa, Sophie in Plymouth, UK, Susan in Canterbury, Connecticut, Kent in Bloomington, Indiana, Amber in Thornbury, Australia, and Joseph in Fitchburg, Massachusetts. Joseph, what are you, wicked schmat?
Okay, if you want to donate to the beer fund, go to truecrimegarage.com and click on the donate button and we like y'all jib.
Yeah, thank you guys and girls. Enjoy some beers in the garage with your friends this evening.
Or just drink the beer by yourself if you want. Just put your headphones on, listen to some True Crime Garage in your garage, and get your jib on.
Captain, tell me about the business.
Well, hopefully, since we had to switch over our RSS feed and we had to switch over our website and all that stuff, hopefully everybody has found us again and welcome back to the garage.
Yeah, apparently downloading our show is the equivalent of the Goonies finding the pirate's treasure. You have to go through a series of puzzles. And you got to avoid the booby traps.
It's a booby trap.
But at the end of the road, if you can figure it out, if you can solve the puzzle, the treasure will be yours.
You get One-Eyed Willie's treasure. Save this for Willie. Anyways, like always, if you want to know anything about the show, go to truecrimegarage.com. You can follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at True Crime Garage. And we read everything. We don't always reply. We don't have a lot of time. We're working full-time jobs, and we're putting out the show. And one day, the show will be full-time. And then we'll reply to everybody. Well, Nick will reply to everybody.
Well, I already applied to everybody in my mind.
Ooh.
And while you're at truecrimegarage.com, click on the donate button, buy us a round of beers for next week's show.
Also,
get in the garage.
People have been asking me, where's the old episodes? They're in the store. Okay, so iTunes makes us only, we're only allowed to hold so many. So the old episodes are in the store. Click there to download. And show some love to the garage.
Is that enough of the business?
That's enough of the business.
All right. Well, the garage door is closing, so come on in, grab a chair, grab your beer.
Grab a beer, people.
Let's talk some true crime.
I'm drunk.
Okay, welcome to Maura Murray. Part 2. So, just a quick friendly garage reminder here. If you did not listen to last week's episode, you'll want to check that one out first because we went through the timeline of the disappearance. We went through some of the characters just to bring you up to speed to where we are now. Here, today, we are here to discuss the different possibilities of what happened to Maura, where is she, and the outcome of that disappearance. Last week, the captain brought up 5 possibilities, and I think each one of them hold merit, and we will dive into each of those 5.
Well, what's fascinating about this case is that she left. She left her school on Monday, and then she went missing that Monday. But why was she leaving? We got to answer that. Why did she leave? And then once she got in the wreck, what happened? Those are the 2 questions in this case.
Yeah, and she left the UMass campus. Depending on who you listen to, depending on what source you find, they will tell you that she left the campus between 4 p.m. and 5 p.m. that day. Well, We know at 7:27 p.m. that day, she made it all the way to Haverhill, New Hampshire. She was involved in some kind of accident, or her vehicle was found on the side of the road.
Mm-hmm.
She or a girl, we got to assume that it was her.
Right.
I get a little sick.
Well, Butch Atwood would talk to somebody, and he identified it as being Mara. So let's just assume it was her.
He says a young female.
Mm-hmm.
But
it was her car.
It was her. It was technically registered to her father.
Mm-hmm.
But police, in the police report, would state that there were indications and proof that Maura Murray was the driver of the vehicle. Now, let's talk about how they found this vehicle, right? We did in the last episode, but we got to touch on it here. They found the vehicle abandoned and locked,
mm-hmm.
and there was damage to the front of the vehicle, and the airbags had been deployed.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what did she say to Butch Atwood? When he stopped to talk to her, he found a young female sitting alone in the vehicle. He says that she appeared to be cold.
Yeah, or she is outside the vehicle.
And
yeah.
frightened.
Mm-hmm.
And she did not want to go with him. He offered to take her back to his home because, you know, to get right. in and from the elements.
In all fairness to her, I mean, Butch was a heavier set guy. And Butch would even say that I'm not like the most friendly looking guy.
Well, not only that, she's out in the middle of nowhere by herself.
Yeah, she doesn't know this area. She doesn't know this guy.
And it's dark. Mm-hmm. It's snowing. It's cold. And I could see not wanting to get in Butch's van or bus and ride with him. But furthermore, he says, hey, I'm going to call police. I'm going to call EMS and get somebody out here to help you. And she says, don't call the police.
Right.
That's what it says in the... police report that she says don't call the police.
Again, this is eyewitness, so not all eyewitness testimony is 100% accurate.
Butch Atwood would also say that Maura had said that she already called AAA. And now a lot of people say, well, that is impossible because there's no cell phone reception up there today, let alone back in 2004.
Right. But this is somebody that has been caught stealing multiple times, so it's not that far of a leap to go, okay, this person steals. Well, maybe this person lies also.
Well, not only that, she kind of had a natural go-to. Okay, so if the vehicle was wrecked or if the vehicle was parked and she's approached by somebody who says that they want to alert the authorities, she has a natural go-to. Why? Because just days before that, she was involved in a vehicular accident,
mm-hmm.
driving her father's car late at night.
Drunk.
And she had called Triple A after that accident.
Right.
So maybe it just becomes a natural thing to just, shoot, this person stumbled upon me. I don't want to talk to anybody. Don't worry about me, sir. I've already called Triple A.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of a go-to, right?
All right. So let's start with the first question, though. Our first question being, why did she leave UMass?
Okay. So there's a few different options here, right? She, you know, we know that she left and,
we know that she wrote a letter to professors, possibly. She worked two places, possibly one of the places, and she also left a note at the other place.
There is some speculation about who she informed about her leaving and about her absence, and also about how long she would be gone.
Yeah, but, and let's just say...
But what we can agree upon is that she did inform some people that she would be leaving and that she would be gone for some time.
Mm-hmm. But I don't want to agree with you on anything just because I don't like you today. I've been working really hard on the show and you're just drinking beer. No, what's difficult about this case is there's all these little tiny facts. Does those facts mean anything? That's the big question. You know what I mean? Like she was caught with a credit card fraud. Doesn't mean anything. Did she inform her work? And does that mean anything? You know what I mean? Like, that's what gets me about this case.
Yeah, those are the questions. But again, I think we can agree that she did inform some of her superiors, whether it be teachers, professors, or supervisors or bosses, that she would be leaving and she would be gone for a period of time. Now, that could be a couple of days. It could be a week.
Up to a week. So
correct. Now, why would she leave? Okay. Why would she want to... There's some options here. Did she want to leave with the idea of committing suicide? Did she leave with the thought of just getting out of Dodge and starting over somewhere fresh, new, you know, starting a new life? Or was her intention to just leave for a few days and then return, like she had told the superiors?
Right, like she just needed a break from everything, you know? And that happens, you know what? That happens a lot more than you think when people are in college going through some difficult times. But normally, them going away for a couple of days or going away for a week is not by themselves. And it's normally not even with a group of people. Most of the time, it's just for them to go home, you know, and kind of recollect their thoughts, get their mental states in order, and go back to school.
So there's some reasons for leaving. Okay, let's go through those right away. So we have the credit card fraud in November of 2003. Some people pointed out that that might be a reason for leaving. I tend to disagree. That happened 4 months before. If I've dealt with it for 4 months, it doesn't seem hard to me to deal with it for another 4 months. Okay. So, and then,
but the reason why they say that is because there's credit card fraud and then she's put on probation. So the fact that she got in a wreck on that Saturday before the Monday she went missing, a lot of people think that would have been enough for her to, oh, you broke your probation. So therefore she would have been possibly kicked out of school.
Yes. Yeah, so
that's a big deal.
Having the accident on Saturday and then leaving Friday afternoon, evening. Now, we also have to mention February 5th. This was the Thursday.
There was a hit and run.
Yes, which actually took place on February 6th, but it was the wee hours of the morning.
Right.
That is the hit and run where Patrice Vassier was found unconscious on the side of the road. Now, there's been quite a bit of people that have been involved in this case, some armchair detectives that seemed to believe that it would be unlikely that she had been involved in that hit and run.
Yeah, and I think they're credible people, and I think they're also pretty logical people that are coming up with this theory. So, you know, when I first heard about this case and started diving into these little details, when I heard about the hit and run, I thought, oh, well, that hit and run happens pretty much early morning Friday. School was closed on that Friday because of snow day. And so the first time that there would be a report of this would be Monday morning. So Maura wakes up and she checks and finds out that this was reported, and it freaks her out. So she had the credit card fraud. She's on probation. She got in the wreck on Saturday, but then she got in the wreck on the Thursday. And now here's why I agree with the idea. I agree with the idea that she probably wasn't involved. But what is weird to me is that Fred shows up on Saturday and they start looking for a car. Now, that could just be a coincidence because her car was a 96. So it was almost 10 years old and it was a Saturn. And, you know, you don't got a lot of swag when you're driving a Saturn.
Yeah, but it's a good college car, you know, for the time, I guess. You know, well, you have to have something economical, I guess. But
you own two, so that's why you're arguing.
But it should be pointed out that the victim in the hit and run, he was not in a vehicle. He was walking across the street. He was struck by a vehicle at some point. And Patrice Vassy, who is the victim in that hit and run, he does not know who hit him. He doesn't have
He didn't die. He was in the hospital for a while, but he didn't die.
He pulled through, and it was pretty traumatic from what I've heard.
Definitely.
But the general consensus is that she probably was not involved in that hit and run. Why? Well, she was at work during the time. Now, the hit and run didn't take place too terribly far from where she was stationed.
Yeah, again, for work. There's that speculation that maybe she just snuck off for a little bit because she did leave work.
Early
that night,
but she left at 1 a.m., which was after Vassier was hit and found.
Right, but the idea is that she left work, like on lunch, like I'm going to go get something to eat. She hits him, comes back to work. She's distraught about it, and that's why she left. See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then she was so distraught that her supervisor had to walk her back. So
well let's talk about what we do know that led up to the point of her supervisor walking her back to her dorm. Now she starts her work day at 7 p.m. that night on Thursday, which her work shift would end on Friday. Now, during the course of the first few hours of work, she's on the phone quite a bit. Now, we said last week that she's on the phone about an hour during the first 3.5 hours of her shift. These are different calls. These are calls with her boyfriend, Billy. This is calls with her sister. And then at some point, she's upset around 1 o'clock or just before 1 o'clock, and she has to be relieved of her duties and escorted back to her dorm.
Uh-huh. Well, here's what's weird. So you get distraught, right? You get distraught talking to your boyfriend, and then you leave to cool off. Or maybe you leave because you need to make a phone call to him again. And then you hit this guy, and then you come back, and you're more distraught. And here's what I thought was funny. Oh, you're so distraught, we're going to walk you back? Maybe that was a ploy. Like, maybe there was damage to her car. I don't know. I'm just throwing it out there.
Well, I can see reasons why people would believe that she was involved in the hit and run, because we have two other accidents that take place within 4 days of that Patrice Vassie's hit and run. Now, so what does that tell me? We either have a very bad driver or a very distracted driver.
Yeah. I think more distracted. I think there was a lot of stuff going on in her head. Now, let's say she was in the hit and run, right? She was involved. That would be a reason to go away for a while. So that answers that question, right? But let's also just assume that she wasn't involved in the hit and run. Then that's not a reason for leaving. So why else would she leave?
Yeah, I'm pointing out here that there was plenty of time to leave if you hit Vassie with your car, right?
Yeah, you could have left that Friday.
Right. If you went into an immediate panic, fight or flight mode, you know, do I stay here and deal with this or just get the hell out of Dodge? There, you could have left that morning. You could have left when classes were closed. You could have left on Saturday. You could have left on Sunday. No, you waited and you left on Monday. So a lot took place during that time period.
Yeah, so yeah, we're kind of leaning towards that she wasn't involved.
Yes, but what does that point out? Like you said, there could be other reasons for leaving. Well, what do we see here leading up to that? We see a lot of phone calls with the boyfriend, which might be a common occurrence. You know,
it's unhealthy either way.
It's a long distance relationship. How are you going to maintain the relationship? Via phone, email, you know,
and dirty pictures.
And that's, you know, so they're probably going to have a lot of communication. That doesn't strike me as incredibly abnormal. What does strike me as abnormal is some of these phone calls at work. Now, that could be normal behavior for Maura. We don't know. But I do believe that
it depends on the job, though, too. And because I think you say it depends on Maura. And look, there's some people, I believe you're a hard worker. I believe I'm a hard worker. But depending on the job, I will take things a little more serious or less serious. So I think that's more based on the job than the character of the person.
Well, but what I'm trying to point out here is we have an hour or just over an hour worth of phone call time, you know, me time. I'm on my phone.
Right. But that's where I'm saying that no matter what, I know that you're long distance. I know that you have to keep in contact. You can do that through emails. You can do that. Now, for the young listeners, this is back in the day. We got home phones and we also have some cell phones. Her cell phone is paid by her boyfriend, Billy, at the time. But, you know, she could call before class, in the break of class, before work. I just think this is a sign of a very unhealthy relationship.
Exactly, and that's what I'm trying to get at. She's on the phone for an hour or just over an hour, and she's only at work for 5 hours. And then she has to be escorted home. Uh-huh. I mean, that's a pretty dramatic thing. I've had to leave work before because I've, you know, fallen ill or there's been a family emergency or something's come up. But I've never had to have somebody walk me home or drive me home.
You humble brag.
Well, no, but I'm just saying that I think something happened there. And who did she talk to? She talked to her boyfriend and she talked to her sister. Yeah. Something was going on either with her family or with her boyfriend. If she was not involved in that hit and run, and that's what we're saying,
right.
Then something's going on with the boyfriend or the sister or her family that requires her to leave.
Yeah. Well, it doesn't require her to leave, but I think, like I said, it's an unhealthy relationship. I think she was a little unhealthy mentally herself, and so she got so distraught by some argument with her boyfriend that she said, I gotta go. And we have some evidence of that. We have some evidence of that because of what she left in her dorm room. A lot of her boxes are packed, and there's a lot of speculation on the boxes being packed and all that stuff. But there was a letter, an email that she had printed out. And the email was basically, I believe it was an email from Billy talking about him cheating on Mara.
Or maybe apologizing for something or trying to stay in the relationship. Who knows? But what we do know is, according to the police report, because there's been this is an area of speculation. Well, we can clear up some of that speculation right here. Mm-hmm. According to the police, now they've given official account of what was found in her dorm. Now, what they would state, they're a little vague here, so we have to read into this. But what they would state is that some of her items appeared to have been packed up.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing was there a suicide note? Because in the beginning of this case, people thought that maybe you would find a suicide note in her dorm,
mm-hmm,
or a goodbye letter or something of that. And they state that there was no note found, no suicide note found. Right. They're specific about that.
Right.
So what that could mean is that you are right. That could mean that there was a note or a letter or an email found, but it was not necessarily a suicidal note.
Correct. Yeah.
And let's talk about some of her belongings or some items of her dorm appear to have been packed. Well, why would you use that word appear? Okay.
Well, because, well,
let's think about that for a second though. Mm-hmm. Okay. Why would I use the word appear if I'm law enforcement? Okay. So there's some of the items packed and some of the other items are just where they should be in her dorm, right?
Yeah.
Well, maybe they appear to be packed because you only packed up belongings that didn't belong to you, that belong to somebody else, that you're going to return them or leave them for somebody to find.
Right, yeah.
And why would you use the word appear to have been packed up? That's what I find interesting in law enforcement's statement. Appear to have been packed up. They didn't seem to think that these were boxes that she showed up to campus with and just never got around to unpacking. They say that these are items that appear to have been packed up.
Yeah. That's kind of a weird wording. I don't know if college students don't always unpack everything. You're going back and forth to home a bunch. So sometimes, I lived in a condo by myself for a long time. It always looked like I was moving, you know.
Again, she didn't arrive that week to campus. She didn't arrive even just, you know, weeks or months, a month before. What I'm saying is that had they seen items in boxes like in your condo, they would have used different wording, in my opinion. I think they would have said, and I can't guarantee this, this is just my speculation.
Right.
But I think that in your case, they would probably say, well, some of his items were boxed up. Some things that he had were packed, or remained unpacked. I think they would have used somewhat different wording. I'm probably reading too much into it.
Yeah,
because
it all depends on the officer and how diligent they were about, you know. I just believe it's all about how diligent they were.
But the key thing to note there, too, is that some of her items, some of her belongings were just where they should be or where you would expect to find them. Some things were in boxes, and there was no suicide note left in her dorm.
Okay, so, but basically what we're getting at is we don't believe that she's involved in the hit and run, but we do believe there's some turmoil with her boyfriend, so that would be a cause for leaving and getting away and clearing your head. It's also cause to maybe want to run away and do harm to yourself.
Yeah, right? I agree with you there, but I also think that we got to point out that there could be turmoil with the boyfriend, or there could be something going on with her family. Because what is the interaction that we see out of Maura leading up to her disappearance? It's a lot of interaction with Billy, and it's a lot of interaction with her father or her sister.
Yeah, but you know, maybe some of that is like leaning on them. And that's the frustrating stuff about this, because it's like, you know, I wouldn't normally call my parents for relationship advice. You know, I've have several times in my life, but that's not really a go-to. I don't know if that would be a go-to for Maura. But either way, there's some turmoil.
Well, don't forget about that weird party. What if that party could have had something to do with why I left college.
Okay, so we're going to go through the timeline a little bit just for the listeners that haven't heard. Go back, listen. So the hit and run happens on Thursday. We're saying
early Friday morning.
Right, that she's not involved, but there's a party Friday.
Well, there's a party on Saturday. This is a party that takes place. Her father comes up. They go car shopping.
Oh, yeah. Nothing happens Friday.
Right. After going car shopping with her father, she goes to a party. Now, this is a bit of a weird area because some of the other members of the party, the hostess of the party, she doesn't tell us much about the party.
Well, she's not the host.
The hostess, I said.
Yeah, but she wasn't really the host, was she?
It was her dorm.
It was her dorm?
Yes. The party was at Sarah Alfieri's dorm, and Maura Murray went there with her friend Kate Markopoulos. So,
well, see, there's so many details about this damn case that it makes my head spin sometimes.
Now, we do have to point out, though, mm-hmm. that both Kate and Sarah have spoken to police, and they've probably told them, they may or may not have told them exactly what had happened, but I'm guessing they told the police a lot more than what they've told anybody else because they've not told anybody else anything other than Fred Murray. Fred Murray has had some conversations with these girls and is probably sitting on some information that he's got from them.
Yeah. Now, a lot of people find it odd that they just don't remember a lot about the party, but I used to live on Ohio State campus. I used to have parties all the time. If you would ask me who showed up, well, there's about 60 people that showed up. Well, who were they? Well, I could name like five. That's how many I could name. I mean, we'd have parties that would have 100 and some people there.
Well, and the reason for the speculation, though,
popular.
There were a few guys who claimed to have been there that evening. But
there's normally guys at parties, yeah.
But the other thing, though, is
it's normally more guys than girls.
Yeah, but what a lot of other people have thought is maybe the reason why this so-called party is so forgotten about was because it wasn't a party at all, that it was just a couple girls getting together, maybe having a couple drinks, talking, hanging out. It may have just been a hangout, you know, right. And we've all seen this on plenty of college campuses. You might have a hangout 3, 4, 5 times a week, It's not so special when you have them all the time, you know, and you're not going to remember every incident.
Yeah, because like Thursday through Sunday, basically, if you live around the campus, you have an apartment, then or dorm, you just kind of hang out, and some people drop by. So, yeah.
Now,
I don't put a lot of weight into the fact that they don't remember everything, and I know that some people do, and I just go, look, I've been to a lot of parties that I don't remember much.
Well, the other thing you pointed out would be what happened just after the party. It's when Maura wrecks Fred's vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
She borrows her father's car for the evening, wrecks the vehicle, does about $8,000 worth of damage to his new car. Mm-hmm. And then she returns to his he's staying at a hotel, and she goes and she tells him about the accident. There's a phone call to Billy from Fred's phone. Now, here's the thing. I understand what you're saying about her possibly being on probation for, this credit card theft. Yeah. And now there's been an accident on campus, and you might be concerned about that. I don't see that being the reason for leaving, and I'll tell you why. Because who do you think she hurt the most by wrecking that car? Probably her father. And it sounds to me like they had a damn good relationship, and I think that that's something that could be worked out between the two of them. Yeah. Now, you're worried about being on probation from college? She's been down this route before. And what did she do? She gracefully bowed out. Mm-hmm. She would have had time to figure this thing out. She would have had time to either present her case and stay at UMass, or she would have stayed there and gracefully bowed out, in my opinion. I don't think that this would cause her to head for the hills just within 48 hours later.
Okay, so let's just go through all this real quick. So we don't think that she was involved in the hit and run, and we don't think that the wreck on Saturday is the cause for her leaving on Monday.
Yeah, and I don't think the party had anything to do with her leaving.
Because it's just this kind of, we don't know much about it. And I know that Renner had a big deal with like Kate, because her accounts of the, I think Kate said something about like walking a guy out to the car and then she kissed the guy, but she couldn't even remember his name. And a lot of people go, well, that's bullshit. We all have been there. We've all got a little tipsy. We've all made out with somebody that we couldn't remember their name. And if you haven't, eh, try it. You know? I'm just, you only live once. Okay. So we don't think it has anything to do with the hit and the run, and we don't think it has anything to do with the party or the accident on Saturday.
Well, one thing that causes me to question all those things, again, is the state of her dorm room, right? So we get a note saying, we get an email, some kind of communication saying to her professors, I'm leaving. I got a death in the family. I'm not going to be back for a while. And then we have some, maybe possibly some packing of items. Other items are left. And basically what we are left with is that she packed up her car. She packed up her damaged Saturn and chose to drive away on Monday. What else am I seeing in this time? I'm seeing a bit of a break in the communication with Billy. There's a lot of back and forth with Billy for a while. Mm-hmm. And then that seems to slow quite a bit. And the communication back and forth at some point starts to become short and few and far between. And I think there's good reason for that. And what do we see on that Monday? Well, she collects a little bit of her belongings. She hops into the Saturn. She drives out of UMass campus. She picks up $280 and she's out on the road.
Yeah. I mean, but what are you saying? She's going to clear her head? What do you think?
Well, that's where we have some options here. Because what did she do before collecting that $280? She didn't pass go. No, she got on her computer. She looked up some condos, looked at some places to possibly go to, mm-hmm. called a ski resort, called in to get information about renting a condo. Mm-hmm. She never successfully rented a condo.
That we know of.
Right. Yeah. She didn't purchase anything with this 1-800-GO-STOW, the ski resort.
Right.
But she did. She was checking into these places. This strikes me as a couple different things. Am I planning for a trip many months from now ahead of time? And I just happen to go, you know, hop in my car and drive away 135 miles to Haverhill, New Hampshire. No, that doesn't make sense. No, it's February. The places that you're inquiring about are out in the wilderness. They're out in beautiful landscapes. It's someplace that you would want to see the snow. And these were places that she had said that similar places that her and her family had gone to when she was younger.
Yeah.
Probably happy times. She's reflecting on happy times.
Well, she's an avid hiker too.
Yes. So. And so you're checking into going skiing. I don't know anybody that goes skiing for the rest of their life. You know, you typically go skiing for a weekend. This is a Monday when she leaves. She's bailing on something. She's getting out of Dodge for a reason. Now, is she stopping off to have a good time before she disappears into the wild blue yonder? I don't know. But this is parts of why would she leave? Now, we gotta talk about here, Captain. Do you think she was leaving for a little bit, or do you think she was leaving for good? And for good, does that mean suicide, or does that mean I'm cashing in my chips and I'm going to go live elsewhere?
Well, I think, you know, she's a nursing student. So, I mean, God bless all the nurses out there. But anybody that has been through that schooling knows that that is a grueling task. Going through a nursing school is very difficult. I believe that with this stuff with Billy, with this coming out that he was cheating on her, maybe there's some family issues, but you know, it seemed like she had, you know, her head on her, you know, other than the credit card thing, she's working two jobs. She's in the nursing program. I think a lot of the stuff was getting a little bit too much, and she just wanted to get in touch again with her spiritual side, you know, and just maybe she felt a little lost. And with all this stuff, with the cheating stuff, she decided, you know, I'm just going to go away and clear my head.
Can I point out some thoughts I have about her family real quick? Sure. And about things that leading up to her disappearance.
Mm-hmm.
So if I take Fred, her father, at his word, which I'm going to, this is a guy that's missing his daughter, okay? And he's continued to look for 12 years.
Well, you're just saying that because you want him to come on the show.
No, I don't want Fred to come on the show at all. Yeah. I have no interest in him being on our show.
Okay.
So, but what I do want to point out here is what do I see Fred doing? How do I see Fred behaving?
He's searching for.
Not only that, but before she goes missing, he comes into town and he's coming cash in hand, and he's telling me that I was there to go look for used cars with my daughter. That she was probably complaining about her vehicle, or something had happened and maybe she needed to lean on dad. And dad swoops in and tries to make things better. Takes her out to dinner, tries to get her mind off
of things. Let's just go back to the car thing, because I've heard a lot of people talk about, well, a girl that's in her, you know, in her 20s and she's in high school, or not high school, in college, that if she knew she was going to get a new car, that she'd be talking about it. And I just find that to be utter bullshit, because one, she's getting some used car. She's just getting another car that was just going to get her through college. It wasn't like she's getting a Lexus or getting a whatever. You know what I mean? So,
but here's the other thing. What if dad is the knight in shining armor? What if dad just strolls into town? She knows that he's coming, and he says, you know what, babe? I know things are tough for you. Your car's running a little rough. Let's go out and look at some cars.
Right, yeah.
I don't think we might not buy anything today, but and then we'll go out to dinner afterwards. Let's just have a good time.
Yeah.
This might just be dad being a good dad.
Yeah.
Dad, you know, being dad. And maybe Maura didn't tell anybody because, one, she didn't know about it beforehand.
Right.
And two, nothing came of it. Or if she did tell anybody, who did she tell? Maybe people at that party that nobody's willing to admit that they were at. Or maybe they were all so drunk that they don't recall what took place that night.
Or maybe they're, you know, just playing Dungeons and Dragons or something, and they don't want to come clean about it.
And dad even took her friend Kate Markopoulos to dinner with them. Yeah. You know, I don't know who picked up the bill, but regardless,
I'm sure dad did.
This is a father that appears to me to be involved in his daughter's life and want to do good things for his daughter. Now, here's the other thing about the family that I want to point out. She has a long phone call with her sister when she's at work that night, when all this stuff is going down. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, probably why this is not problems with her family, this might be problems with Billy. That same sister is now divorced from her husband. Who knows what relationship they had, but maybe she was calling up sis to get advice to how do I handle this? Or have you gone through this same thing before?
Yeah. Well, sometimes people just have a person they vent to in their life, you know, and sometimes that's a sibling. And so I could totally see that, you know, you know, her older sister, somebody that she calls and vents to, and that's what she's doing about Billy, and she's getting some advice, you know, and maybe that's what I wish the family would talk about more was, you know, did she talk about like just needing to step away from everything for a while, you know?
So, of course, we don't think it's the hit and run. We don't think it's the party. We don't think it's the family. These are not reasons that we think that she wanted to leave. We think that the reasons didn't have anything to do with school either. But for whatever reason, all arrows point that she wanted to leave. They all point that she wanted to leave. We don't know if that means for a little while or forever. But that what it does mean is that she's leaving either because of her or because of her and Billy.
So even if it's because of her and Billy, it could have also just been for herself. This guy cheated on me. There's been a lot going on. I just need to step back and I need to find myself.
Could be to clear her head. Could just be, you know, her and Billy. But what do people say about the relationship with her and Billy?
Yeah, it's weird because, again, one side of the relationship is it was good. They're planning on getting married. And then there's a lot of other talk that it wasn't good, that Billy was maybe a little manipulative or maybe even abusive at times. And I don't know if that is just mentally or verbally or who knows, maybe he's just controlling. I mean, there's a lot of phone calls back and forth, and most of my friends that are guys would not be making those phone calls all the time because they're guys. They don't want to be talking on the phone all that much. But if you're a controlling guy, then you want to know everything.
Well, so, and I don't know how it works completely, but let's point out here, you know, abusive or controlling or whatever, he is in Oklahoma. You know, it might be easy to get away from him when you're in Massachusetts. However, controlling, yes. Who pays the cell phone bill? Is that because Maura couldn't afford it? Or is that because I want to control the phone calls? Yeah. Or I want to check the voicemail? Usually, when you pay the bill, you have access to all things the phone. Record.
Yeah. So, I mean, we know that he cheated. We also know that maybe she wasn't super faithful as well as we have the student track coach. But so, okay, so he cheated. So that's a reason to get away. The other reason is there's a lot of talk about what she's searching on the internet. She's searching for places to go to, but she's also searching for pregnancy. You know, how much you can drink while you're pregnant and things like that. So the other speculation was that possibly she had a pregnancy scare. You know, so cheating, maybe it's just a breakup. Maybe it's a pregnancy scare. I don't know. But those are the reasons for Billy. At the end of the day, it's either just for herself to get away, or and she could just be getting away with herself, or maybe she's getting away with a group of people, or she, or it's these reasons because of Billy.
So, well, here's what I'll say. I believe that there are people out there that probably have spoken to Maura about why she left, and they don't even know that that's why she left. I believe that she probably had some discussions with Kate or Sarah or her sister Kathleen. I don't know that this is something she would have went to her father with,
right.
Because she from everything I've heard was a good girl that didn't want to burden her father with different things. And I think that maybe unbeknownst to them that at some point either her sister or her two friends had a conversation with her and maybe probably try to help her and give her some good advice. She was seeking help and she decided to leave. And between the lines of that, those conversations or a conversation is the reason that she left.
Yeah. I mean, she could be talking to her sister. Right. And then her sister says, you know, you just need some time apart, you know, from Billy or whatever. And she could go, yeah, you know, I just need some space. And that could have been like just a little indicator. Now, her sister probably took that as she just needs some space from the relationship. But maybe she just needs space from everything. Anyways, those are probably the more likely scenarios. So then she drives up 100 and how many miles away?
134 to 135 miles approximately. And the vehicle's found in Haverhill, New Hampshire. We know that along the way, she picked up that $280 cash. She stopped off at a liquor store to make some purchases. There was some alcohol found in her car. Her car was found locked and abandoned. And the other thing here, this is, to me, you know, there's what we went through so far. A lot of people would consider forks in the road.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I think we've deduced it enough that we've made our way through all those forks.
Yeah, we have less forks now.
We have no forks so far.
Well, we still have forks.
No, we have made a straight path from UMass all the way up to Haverhill, New Hampshire.
Okay,
so to me, here's the first fork in the road. The first fork in the road to me is something that may have happened before she left or definitely happened before the scene of the accident,
mm-hmm.
is the rag in the tailpipe. What do we know about this rag in the tailpipe?
I've heard so many different stories, and I don't even know if it matters too much with the car. I mean, a lot of people think it's you put the rag in the tailpipe, and then you would sit in your car and you would die, right?
Yeah, I guess that's some people would think that. I don't see how that would happen.
I don't see how that makes any sense.
That doesn't make any sense to me. What I'm talking about, though, is there's been speculation that Fred knew in advance that there was a rag in the tailpipe. Uh-huh. And there's been speculation that he didn't know anything about it. Now, I've been told and have heard that when he found the car that he pulled the rag out of the tailpipe and the car started right up. So maybe he knew it was in there.
Right.
But here's what I'm getting at is we know that she stopped for gas because her vehicle, it was almost full when it was found on the side of the road. So she had to have stopped for gas somewhere along the way.
Right.
And probably within the last 30 to 40 miles. Now, if I'm a young woman, I'm out somewhere and I'm gassing up my car and somebody sees me that wants me to fall victim to them. Well, maybe when I go in to pay cash to prepay for my gas, because we know she paid cash, right?
Well, I mean,
we're assuming you have to assume
we don't have any debit card records.
No credit card, debit card records of her buying, purchasing gas, or we would know where she purchased the gas from.
Right.
So what if I'm Mr. Handy Dandy and I figure out, you know what? I'm going to go stuff something in her tailpipe. Remember what that was? What was that? Beverly Hills Cop. He stuffs the banana in the tailpipe and the car won't start.
Yeah, but the car would start, but she drove away from the gas station.
Right, but maybe my thought is that the car would start and drive away from the gas station. At some point, I will follow you, and your car will stop running.
It's going to stall out.
Because it's not exhausting properly.
Right. I just wonder how long that would take. I mean, she was, you know, probably a couple ticks off a full, so it took a while if that was the case.
What we do know is somebody didn't stuff it in there and follow her, trail her bumper to bumper and wait for the car to die and then abduct her. Why do we know that? Because Butch Atwood saw her at the scene of the crime, and he saw nobody else, or at the scene of the accident, I'm sorry. And he saw nobody else.
Right.
Now, what did he see? This is what boggles me too. He saw a woman that was frightened. He thought frightened. Who knows? Maybe she wasn't frightened. But he says that she appeared to be cold or shivering. Now, if she's shivering, how long until your car is dead do you have to sit there before you're cold enough to the point where you're shivering?
Yeah.
And we've also heard that the car was operable. If you're shivering, why was the car not on? Why don't you turn on the vehicle? Maybe she hit her head. Maybe she was messed up from the accident and couldn't think of such a thing. Right. Now, Butch Atwood did say that the lights of the vehicle, they weren't on when he pulled up.
Yeah.
So we don't think the car was running. But I'm in the car and I'm shivering.
Yeah, maybe she just assumed that it wasn't going to start. The airbags deployed and she just assumed it wasn't going to start, so she didn't even try.
727 Faith Westman calls in to 911 that there's a vehicle in the ditch. Now this is Mara's vehicle. Butch Atwood believes that he was at the scene at 7:30. And we go by the captain's logic here. You could give or take 5 minutes on either end of that, right?
Right.
So he could have actually seen her at 7:25, or he could have seen her at 7:35. So let's go off of the 911 call from Faith Westman at 7:27 when the vehicle is there. Now, the first officer to respond to the scene of the accident is at 7:46. We have a 19-minute window.
Yeah.
Something happened.
That's a long time.
Something happened in the course of 19 minutes that took Maura from her vehicle to never be seen again.
Yeah. And, you know, when they did the search with the dogs sniffed to the middle of the road. So I don't know how far away it was, 50 feet, 100 feet to the middle of the road. And then they stopped having a scent to follow.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. They followed, they believed that the dogs were, you know, here's the thing. These dogs are trained, and I actually don't think that people give enough faith in these dogs. I think that they do. There's a reason why we've used them for so long, and a properly trained dog is extremely valuable to investigation. Yeah, I mean,
they found a lot of people in the woods and stuff because of the dogs.
Yeah, so these dogs followed her trail down the road for a little while, and then they just stopped.
In the middle
of the road.
And what I think that says is that she would have to get in the passenger, in the back of somebody's car. She'd have to get in the back of somebody's car, either side.
Yeah, passenger side, back of the car. It doesn't matter what side. They lost the trail because there was no longer any footprints. There was no longer any Maura Murray scent to follow.
Right.
But back to the rag in the tailpipe. As I was trying to say, is that we know that somebody didn't follow her bumper to bumper because there was Butch Atwood that had seen her by herself. Now, maybe that person lie in wait somewhere, and maybe he or she picked her up somewhere along the way. But
it doesn't make a lot of sense to me because you have to, one, assume that this is going to work, and we don't know for a fact if that works. And then we also have to assume that she's going to get in the car with you or that
you could make her get in the car. Right. Now, but here's the other thing that I want to point out. If you're going to do that to somebody, why did Butch Atwood see her shivering? She didn't just sit there for 30 seconds. You don't just wreck your car and now you're shivering all of a sudden. If she's outside of the vehicle, yes, it's very cold. It might not take very long. Who knows? But it seems strange to me that she is shivering when Butch Atwood finds her. That to me tells me that she's there for a couple minutes or so.
Right. Long enough where the guy would have had an opportunity.
If you were going to follow her like that, yeah.
And again, that brings me back to the point of this case is so frustrating because does the rag in the tailpipe mean anything, or is it just something that you should just move past and not even worry about it?
Well, I think a big part of this case, too, is what the police believed they were responding to. You know, they show up and they believe they're responding to an accident. And they have a witness who tells them that he had spoken to her.
Yeah.
And she's alone.
Mm-hmm.
Now, see, had I been investigating and I found the rag in the tailpipe, I would have been really concerned. I would have called out, you know, everybody. I would have sent out the National Guard. But having spoke to the witness who said that she's alone, that yeah. puts my walls down a little bit. That makes me, what do I think I'm seeing here? Well, this looks like an accident. This looks like somebody that lost control or was distracted while they were driving. And, oh, there's alcohol in the car. And there appears to be open containers of alcohol. So right. now I think that I probably got a drunk driver.
Fleeing from the scene.
This drunk driver does not want to get caught, does not want to go to jail, and yeah. took off.
Okay, so let's break down these five possibilities. So the first one being that she fled from the scene, and then she succumbed to the elements.
This brings us to the point in the game where she has spoken to somebody, and now she believes that cops are on the way. So what can we deduce from this moment? So she was perfectly fine to stay with the vehicle until she's told that cops are on the way, right? Mm-hmm. So this means that either something happened to her before the cops could arrive in this 15 to 19 minute time period, or she decided to leave. Why would she decide to leave? Is she trying to carry out her suicide plan? Is she trying to just flee the scene and succumb to the elements?
Well, yeah, I don't know if she would be trying to.
Well, of course, no, but she's trying to flee the scene and didn't have provisions and fell victim to the elements.
So let's go down that rabbit hole. So okay. Fight or flight, she goes home. Oh, cops are coming. I got to get out of here. So she takes off. Now, we do have an eyewitness that claims that he saw her 8 miles away about 40 minutes later. That is a distance that she could cover as a track star. But I find that unlikely because, okay, so the idea would be like if the reason why she left was to commit suicide, then when she got there, then there was a failed attempt because she got in a wreck, but now she has to carry this out. So she takes off running. She takes off running, then she's going to run in the woods and then commit suicide. And we haven't found her, but maybe we should start the search, you know, past 13 miles. Now, that's a crazy, you know, giant area to search. The problem is with that theory is the dogs.
Yes. And the problem with both of those theories is the dogs. The dogs don't care if it's 300 yards or 2 or 3 or 4 miles. They're going to keep following that trace and that scent as long as they can.
Right.
And at some point, the scent just disappears.
Right. And is it possible that, and here's the problem with that theory to me, is if she just took off running to commit suicide, or she just took off running to get away and then she died because of the cold or whatever, why would she start running in the middle of the road? You know, like the trail goes to the middle of the road. Like, I would believe it more if the trail stopped at the side of the road and maybe she started running in the grass or whatever. But the trail stops in the middle of the road. So I feel like if you have any signs or anything pointing you to, I think she left on that Monday because she wanted to commit suicide, then I think that just goes out the window when you go, well, there's no proof of that. There's no proof that she left. There's not much proof that she, even if the dogs could track her for a mile, that would make more sense to me, but they couldn't track her that far at all.
Well, here's why I think we believe in the dogs. Okay, there's the the police officer, along with a resident from the area, fire, and EMS. There's multiple people there. Now, a lot of people have said, well, the cops shoot off fire and EMS way too early. No, I think what they did was I think they assessed the situation and they took a good look around to see if there was any evidence to figure out where this person might have gone. Well, there's no tracks in the snow, right? We've been told that that night they saw no tracks in the snow. They saw no evidence of her fleeing into the woods or off in any direction at all. So, and then we get the dogs who don't run out into the woods. They don't run out into no man's land. They go right down the road and follow this scent or follow something that they believe belonged to Maura down the road.
Right. And then again, the other thing too, so you can kind of rule out that she ran away and committed suicide in the woods. You can also kind of rule out that she ran away and then died because of the elements. I also think that she was a very tough person. I just don't think she would have let it get that far.
Well, she wasn't prepared for the elements. I think we can agree on that. But the other thing was there was several comprehensive searches for her.
Uh-huh.
And Fred was involved in a lot of those searches. And he tells us he believes that she was met with foul play, or maybe she's living somewhere far away.
Mm-hmm.
But he has been witness and privy to information that took place during those searches. They used a helicopter. They used dogs. They used officers. They used volunteers. They searched the area. They didn't find anything. Now, I'm with you, Captain. They probably didn't search 8, 9, 10 miles away, but they searched the general area.
But again, with the dog sniffing evidence, it's, less likely.
There's been no backpack found, and there's been no sign of Maura found.
So we can kind of start just leading to this idea that she is at her car. Butch comes up. She denies help from him. And then her scent goes missing in the middle of the road, which would lead to the idea that she either got picked up by somebody she knew, she got in a car willingly, or she was forced into a car.
Yeah, and let's talk about those three different options, okay? So first of all, let's go to she got into the car willingly, all right? Now, what behavior have we seen out of Maura before, just minutes before?
Mm-hmm.
She would not get into the vehicle with Butch Atwood. So that tells me, now Butch says, I'm not the most friendly looking guy.
Yeah, he's a heavier set guy.
Okay, well, maybe she's selective about who she gets in the car with. I don't know. But if I have to go by her previous behavior, what that tells me is that she would not get into a car with somebody other than somebody she knew or somebody she trusted.
Right. Or somebody forced her.
Or somebody, somebody could make her get into a vehicle.
Right, right. Yeah. So, but it's possible, it's possible that, she wouldn't get in the car with a guy. But there was a girl, or there was a couple. And, I'll trust the couple more than I'll trust just this single guy.
We have seen that in previous cases.
Yeah.
We've even seen where people will use children to lure people into a vehicle. But again, we are stuck on the middle of the road. She either got into a car with somebody she knew and or trusted.
Mm-hmm.
Or she was forced into a vehicle.
Yeah.
Now let's talk about why would she know somebody? She doesn't know anybody 135 miles from UMass up in the middle of New Hampshire. She doesn't know anybody up there.
Well, yeah, but out of those 5 points, if she's forced in or got in with the wrong person, then we probably will never know what happened to her because there's no eyewitness of that. And unless somebody finds her remains on somebody's property or something, we're never going to know that scenario. Or if somebody did hold her hostage for a long time. The only way we'd know that is if she got free. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So like if that's the case, but then how random is that? That somebody just happens upon this person? I don't know. To me, that just seems so... hard to think that somebody would just see somebody out there, you know, and I'm going to stop and help them, but not help them.
I disagree. And I tell you why. And I know that it does seem, it is random. It definitely is random. However, I don't think it's entirely that random. A lot of abductions that we have discussed on our show and that we've read about are crimes of opportunity.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, there are people that travel around with things in their vehicle or they...
just looking for the opportunity.
They might not always be looking for the opportunity, but on occasion they are.
Right.
And sometimes the opportunity presents itself and they take advantage. So it's not, you know, I've heard astronomical numbers, huge numbers. It's so incredibly random. I don't think it's that incredibly random.
Yeah. I think she's a fighter, though. I think if somebody tried to force her into a car, that she would have fought a little more. And I think maybe people would have seen that. And look, these people were calling the cops and stuff. And I know we said anywhere from a 5-minute window to like a 15-minute window. But how many times were those eyewitnesses looking out and they didn't see anything? And I just feel like here's my thought. Is if it was somebody that she didn't know, there would be more conversation, right? You know, or if there was a tussle or they tried to force her into the car, I think there would have been more opportunity for somebody to see that. There would be less opportunity to see that if she's driving somewhere tandem, right?
Well, just real quick. There was at least one homeowner in the area of the accident that said that they could see vehicles passing by the scene of the accident, but they couldn't make out descriptions of the vehicles or license plates because it was so dark.
Right.
So there was other traffic on that road that night, which would point to what we're talking about, either an abduction or getting into a vehicle of somebody you knew. Right. Trusted. Again, her previous behavior, she wouldn't get into Butch's car. So what I'm getting at here is if we react to seeing her reaction to Butch, it means to me that she wouldn't just get into anybody's car at that point.
Right.
She was forced in, or this was somebody she knew. Now, what are the theories out about those two items? So we have, was she traveling with other people? Were these people that she knew that she had left the UMass campus with, or people that she knew outside of UMass and were going to meet her somewhere, or had traveled, met up with her at some point, and they were traveling in tandem? There's been talk about maybe there was a vehicle in front of her, because that's what somebody would have to think about. If she was traveling in tandem with somebody, she would have already have left the scene of the accident before Butch even showed up, had the vehicle been following her, right? You would just pick her up, gather your things. Unless you fell way behind, she would gather some of her things, hop in your car and drive off. That's a possibility.
Unless you see her go off the road and you're like, oh shit. And you just drive past and now you have to go to the next stop. And here's the argument. A lot of people think if somebody was in front of her or behind her, that there's about a seven. I mean, if you follow all the eyewitness accounts, it's not a 5-minute window or a 15-minute window. It's about a 7-minute window. So if you drove up to the next spot where you could turn around and come back, that's about a 7-minute trip. So the thought is that she gets in this wreck, she gets out. The person that is following her tandem, it has to go to the next point to turn around. And Butch Atwood talks to her and she's like, no, don't worry about it. You know, don't call the cops. And the person turned around and picked her up and then took her. Now, if you believe that, then why was she leaving?
Okay, so some of the items in her dorm appear to have been packed up, right? Mm-hmm. That was from the police report. Some items appear to have been packed up. Well, were those items not hers? Did they belong to somebody else? Or were these items that you intended to leave for a specific person? Was there a suicide note? No. We know there was no suicide note, according to police. But there could have been a different note. There could have been an email. There could have been a print-off of something that could have been left with these belongings. Now, why would you do that?
You're trying to prove a point to somebody.
You're trying to prove a point. You've left these items for somebody to find later. Now, why would somebody find these items? Well, they would either I've gone missing and I've disappeared into the wild blue yonder, and these items get presented to you at some point, or maybe I knew that you planned to come and visit me and you would find these items mm-hmm. and be distraught and destroyed by finding this.
Right.
Maybe that's my final get back at you.
Right. But so now are you driving in tandem just to get away with your buddies for, a couple days or a week? Or are you trying to disappear forever?
I think in that situation, you're either suicidal or you're disappearing forever. Because packing something up for somebody else to find or for something to be delivered to somebody else tells me you're never coming back.
No, I understand that. But we know that at the wreck that, you know, it's not that likely that she ran off into, like we said, it's not that likely she ran off into the woods to commit suicide. And why would her friends drive her to a place that she would commit suicide and never talk to the family about it?
Right.
It doesn't make a lot of sense.
Right. So I think what we can say is that if she was riding in tandem with somebody, that she has decided to disappear forever. Because had she succumbed to the elements or went off and committed suicide somewhere in the woods and she was riding in tandem with somebody, those people would have came out at some point and said, no, I know she's in the hills. You got to keep searching. I know she's in the hills. We went off on this trip together. It was just going to be for a week, or we were going to help her get away and she disappeared. You got to go find her.
Right, right.
And those people have not come forward. That leaves us with only the two options. She went in tandem with somebody, got into a car of somebody she trusted and knew, and they drove her off to where she's spending her time now, or she got into a car unwillingly and was abducted and either captive or unfortunately not with us anymore.
Right. Now, my problem with her running away and starting a new life is maybe there's some evidence to point to that. I mean, look, if you're in this weird relationship, you have a lot going on for you in nursing school. And I know a lot of people don't make it through nursing school, but she's pretty far along. So what would be your reason, to get away from a not stable relationship? I mean, you're really kind of away from him anyways, so then there is that speculation that she was Googling a lot about possibly being pregnant. How much alcohol can you drink while you're pregnant and stuff like that was searched on her computer. So I guess the theory would be that she was pregnant and then she was trying to get away from Billy.
Or she just needed a life change. Maybe she just needed a life change. Okay, so here's what we talk about her behavior and not getting into Butch's car. Let's talk about her other previous behavior that we've seen before. Okay, now, I'm not saying that the Murray family is not a great family and that there's not great people in that family. I'm sure that there are. What I'm saying is it doesn't seem to me, they might have been close in emotions and relationship, but they're not close in proximity, right? I mean, Maura has lived at two different colleges off by herself for a few years now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, when the going got tough, she abandoned West Point. And maybe when some other things happened when she got to UMass, she decided to abandon UMass as well.
Right.
And maybe at some point that meant, I'm just going to, I don't want to burden my father or whomever with whatever's going on, or maybe I just want a fresh start.
Yeah, I'm going to get away.
I'm not just going to walk away from college this time. I'm going to walk away from all of it.
Yeah, and the guy, the track coach that she was, having an affair with, I guess, or having some relationships with, there was a lot of talk. He brought up multiple times, you know, the interesting thing about him was he was really forthcoming with like people like James Renner that tracked him down. And he was like, no, look, I had a relationship with her. I don't think if you were involved in her disappearance, would you come forth that easily with that information? Yeah, we had a relationship with each other, but we weren't doing that at the time. But she talked about multiple times of just disappearing.
Not only that, we're also, what did we just say? She either got into a car willingly or she was abducted. Okay, mm-hmm. So there's no communication. We have all this communication that we can see between her and her father, between her and Billy, between her and her sister and her friends. Mm-hmm. There's no phone calls in there to Hussein Baghdadi. You know, we don't see any phone calls. She wasn't planning a trip with him.
Right, right.
He wasn't riding in tandem with her. There would have been communication for that, unless they're getting together like some kind of CIA operatives and discussing this over coffee, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. But I don't see any phone calls to him leading up to this. And this is a major event. She didn't decide to leave 6 months before she left. She decided to leave at the last minute, I think, within a day or two of when she left.
She could have had somebody else on the side, though.
But
that we've never heard of.
No, we know, but we're just talking about the track coach at this point, right. Hussein Baghdadi. Okay, so if he was involved in her disappearance, that means he followed her for 135 miles away from campus and just happened to be in the same area and was able to track her there. That doesn't make any sense. He's not involved in this.
Yeah, well, I mean, you could put it in the idea of, hey, I got to get away. Hey, you want to get away? And he says, oh, well, I can be gone for a couple days, but I got to get back at this point. So that would be a reason why they would drive tandem. It's possible that she was riding tandem with somebody that wanted to do harm to her. It's possible.
That is possible.
So basically, I mean, what we're saying is we don't think that this guy had anything to do with her disappearance. He just seemed to be kind of out of her life at this point as a main figure.
So that puts us at our final fork in the road. And I think we've clipped off and chipped off a lot of the other forks. But it leaves us with just that. It looks like a lot of evidence points to her getting into a vehicle. Somebody she knew or somebody took her. Yeah. Now, as you said, if somebody took her, she's either dead or being held somewhere.
Right.
And we don't know where that is. Now,
I hope that son of a bitch doesn't listen to our show.
Now, if she got into a vehicle with somebody she knew, it's probably somebody that she had a lot of communication with leading up to this. And that would be probably Kate or Sarah. You know, her two friends from UMass. Where were they during that weekend or that Monday or Tuesday?
Right.
You know, and the other thing, was it her sister? She had conversations with her sister. I don't think it was her sister. Why? Her sister was notified about the disappearance and notified their father. And I think that if the sister was involved and knew where she was, I think if any family member was involved, Fred would know what's going on and Fred would probably have backed off at some point.
Yeah. Cause I mean, he searched for a long time. And I still don't think he's fully backed off. I mean, there is some argument about that. I mean, a lot of people think, like, here's what we do know. Is everybody's different. And everybody would react different. And if your child went missing, you would act different than I would act. So, you know, maybe 5 years after looking, some author approaches me and says, I want to write a book about your daughter's story and I want to bring light to the subject. And maybe I'd go, hey, you know what? That's a great idea. Maybe I'd be on every podcast. My gut tells me I would. My gut tells me I wouldn't shut the fuck up. You hear me on the show. I don't shut up anyways, but I feel like that's what I do. But you can't put any guilt or blame on Fred for not doing those things. Cause also we don't know how much he's talked to news reporters or how much other stuff he's talked about. What we do know is he hasn't been talking to James Renner. Maybe he just doesn't like the guy. You know, he hasn't talked to Missy Mara Murray. He hasn't talked to us. He hasn't, whatever. But he's not going on a million shows talking about this. But
in Fred's defense, we've not approached him. Now, he's spoken to law enforcement. He's spoken to Dateline. And he has spoken to government officials, whether it be the governor or senator or, you know, people involved in New Hampshire.
Right.
And he's asked them for answers. Yeah. You know, he might just, you know, who cares?
Who cares that he didn't talk to an author or didn't talk to,
you know, he might be an old school guy and he has his agenda.
If she went missing on purpose, I don't think he knows.
No, he doesn't.
You know, and I think that's sad. And if she did go missing on purpose, it's like you're not committing any crime for just wanting to start a new life.
Yeah. Could you mail an anonymous letter or I mean, it wouldn't have to be anonymous. It'd be from you. But could you mail it from a parts unknown, you know, kind of thing to your father?
Yeah. No. Okay.
But the other thing that we have to believe here is if she went missing and is living elsewhere and friends helped her do this, these are people that have decided they're not going to reach out to the Murray family.
Yeah, and there's some speculation that they have reached out. But again, why would Fred put up this front? It doesn't make a lot of sense to me.
I do think, though, if she made it out of those hills alive, that she had help from somebody. Mm-hmm. And that's probably somebody she knew.
Yeah. And look, and there is also, I think, even a smaller possibility of that she got in a car with just a stranger and the stranger dropped her off someplace and maybe he just didn't live in that area and just never heard of her disappearance. But that, to me, that's a very small chance and that she just went off on her own. She was just driving by herself and her plan was just get away from everybody. I think that's just a very small chance. So what's your final thoughts? What's your final belief?
My thoughts are exactly that. If she made it out of those hills alive, that somebody helped her and it was probably a friend or somebody that she trusted. And what I mean by that is that if she was traveling alone and not in tandem with somebody, unfortunately, I don't believe she's alive anymore.
Well, the captain's thought is...
No, I'm not finished because I tell you what, here's the thing.
Rude.
If she didn't make it out of those hills, that means she was abducted by somebody. That means she was picked up by somebody that had ill intentions. Now, here's the thing. Here's where I have a big problem with this, okay? Now, you have said the FBI is probably involved in some fashion and we don't need to know how they're involved.
Right.
I get that.
They're always involved.
But here's the thing. You have a father who's demanding answers. He's not getting a lot of answers from that local law enforcement. Now, local law enforcement has stood by their beliefs that Maura disappeared on her of her own will.
Right.
That she wanted to go missing. That she took off on her own. And they're kind of at a loss. Okay? Yeah. Now,
there is some speculation that the police did it. But...
No, I don't think the police were involved in her disappearance. I think that maybe the police did have a little bit of Keystone Cop in them,
mm-hmm.
meaning that it's a little bit of, you know, we run the police force, we run the sheriff's department up here, and we kind of do our own thing, and we do it right. You don't need to worry how we're doing it. We get the job done at the end of the day.
Don't you worry about it. And in that area.
But why is it Keystone Cop? And I'll point it out to you. The strange thing about the area to me that shows me how kind of Keystone Cop it is that the Lavoie's towing company tows the vehicle away, right? And Lavoie's is owned and operated by a firefighter or the fire chief.
Right.
So that shows me what kind of town this is. Nothing against the people that live there. But I'm going a little bit against how the town is operated, the infrastructure. Okay, so if my town, the police chief or the fire chief and the tow truck company is operated by the same guy, well, that seems a bit of double dipping, and it seems a little loosey goosey to me, right?
Yeah.
Am I crazy?
Yeah. No, you're crazy, but.
But I think there's something pointed out here, right? That if you have those kind of ties with things, that there needs to be I don't think that the cops did anything wrong. I think here's the thing, man. This is what bugs me out. I think they showed up to the scene of an accident. There were signs of open containers and alcohol. They believed that they were witnessing a DUI that resulted in an accident and the person had fled. I believe that that's probably something that they come across on a regular basis.
Yeah.
So what happens as when you're a cop and you see this, you go under that notion that, oh, I've seen this before. I know how to investigate it.
Yeah.
Then boom, you wake up 3 days later and it's a missing persons case. And now all of a sudden you fucked up and you didn't investigate it right. Yeah. Well, you didn't know. When you showed up that night, it was not a missing persons case as far as you knew.
Right, right. All signs pointed to this DUI flee.
Yeah. However, I think that the cops have made some moves to kind of cover their butts, which is fine. They should cover their butts. But at the same time, you should involve the family in the investigation, especially if you don't believe that they're involved in the disappearance of this person.
Right.
If you have the father knocking on your door... and begging for answers.
We haven't paid for that yet.
And wanting to know what happened to his daughter, you got to either include him or you have to come up with some answers here. And if he wants to get the FBI involved, kudos to him, because guess what? Our country is built on checks and balances, right? In the way that we run our system.
Yeah, and I like his quote, you know. It's not his quote, but the quote of, you know, who's going to police, you know. The police.
Yeah.
Who's going to police the police themselves? And Tim and Lance on Miss Maura Murray, they said, who's going to police the podcasters?
And I think that Fred is coming off in a way that he's saying, you know what? I want the FBI to investigate the cops. That's not how he is, in my opinion. It might come off that way. But what I think he's trying to say is, can we have somebody else that might be more interested or more informed take a look at this case through different eyes?
Yeah, because basically you guys have come up with some thoughts and you just stop there.
And yeah, and it's 12 years later and they've come up with nothing. They right. have nothing. They from March 2 of 2004, they've presented no other options or no other answers since
yeah.
then.
Yeah.
It's been 12 years. Let's let somebody else look at this. And you know what? All of those people, the FBI, the police, guess what? Guess who pays their bills? The victims in this crime or disappearance. It might not be a crime at all, but the victims and the people that live in the area. And I think that they owe that to us to have somebody else look at this thing and get some answers. Captain, you wound me up and you let me go. Now I need to hear your thoughts. I need to cool down.
Well, I to tell you the truth, I honestly don't know. And when Aurelia told me, hey, you got to check out this case, my first thing into this case was, I think, the 2020 or something. And I saw a couple minutes. And again, it seems like such a simple case. And then it's like you open up these, you peel back these onion layers and you're just peeling back. And there's just more and more and more. And it becomes more questions of why she left that Monday. And then more questions about what happened at the scene, you know, because if you think that she was trying to run away forever, then all this evidence points to that at the scene as well. So I think this is a case that I'll continue to be interested in. I know I'm very interested to the Missing Maura guys are going to be working on a documentary. I'm very interested in seeing that. I've seen some clips and some trailers for that. Which has our good buddy James Renner in it as well. And that's very creepy. I look forward to reading James Renner's book and getting some more information. This is a case that it's really kind of like a thinking man's case. Mm-hmm. And because all it is pondering, taking an idea and just pondering on it. And I think that's why I enjoy this case. And I think I'll continue. I lean more towards foul play. Than her just running away and never contacting her father, because signs don't point to that. But there's always interesting things coming up in this case. A lot because of the true crime community staying on this stuff that's come out on the internet, stuff that's come out on different podcasts. So there's just been a bunch, and I think those are some interesting points we should bring up real quick.
Well, and for me, this case, I actually looked into this case probably 5 or 6 years ago, and I got into it for a couple of months, and then I had to set it aside because there wasn't a lot of new information coming out at the time. And it has picked up some steam with other people working on it, and, you know, those armchair detectives and those cyber sleuths, and the podcasters and everybody that's been involved, and James Renner, of course, but that have brought me back into it. And this has kind of been a case for me where I kind of check in and check out. You know, I check in every couple of years and I check back out, you know, and we had to check back in because we were going to do the show. Now, for me, this case has always been about the fork in the road. And what I mean is that there's all this stuff leading up to her disappearance. You know, there's all this stuff leading up to her leaving campus, all this stuff leading up to the accident scene. And where did she go after that? There was, when you first look at it, for me, there was a million forks in the road. Now, I think that we've spent enough time on it. I've spent enough time on it. I'm only left with two forks in the road. I've pinged them all off, and I'm not trying to prove to anybody that I have a theory that's right.
Right, right.
I'm just presenting
logically.
I'm just presenting to you what worked for me, because at the end of the day, I do need some answers. Unfortunately, here for me, I don't have the final answer, and I don't know that I ever will until there's new evidence or new proof presented to me.
Mm-hmm.
But to me, the two things I can't get out of my head, I've pinged everything off except for these two things. The rag in the tailpipe still confuses me a lot, and I don't know where to go with that. And the other thing is, I think at the end of the day, that those dogs did follow her trail to the middle of the road. Yeah. And I think that that's where her feet left the asphalt. And it left there because she got into somebody's car. And that was either willingly or by force. A couple other interesting things that have taken place since the disappearance was some, you know, internet activity by some people that trying to get involved in the case, maybe, or just muddle the case, I guess.
Yeah, I think you have that with any case that starts picking up steam, or any. There's a lot of cases that, like JonBenet Ramsey, if you start Googling, you can find thread after thread, and you can get involved in that. There were some videos made by a guy, and some of them are just a little strange. He's playing some music in his basement. He's dancing around, but one of the videos was really strange because he's just looking at a screen and he starts laughing. And he laughs for about a minute and a half. And then after he's done laughing, he smiles and winks at the camera. And then it pops up, happy anniversary. And this guy's name is 112 Dirtbag or something like that.
And he's laughing on the anniversary of Mara's disappearance.
Anyways, when this video posted, everybody really said, oh, this guy's creepy as hell. And he probably had something to do with it. I don't believe that for a second. I just believe this guy just wants to be involved. I think he's just a lonely guy, and he's involved in that way. He also had some conflict with James Renner, and I think we'll touch on that in the interview. I'm not for sure, but again, James,
yeah,
it freaked out James Renner, but again, I just think the guy's kind of a lonely man and had nothing better to do. The other thing that I find interesting that I'm going to be diving into more as I look into this case is Billy's phone records the day she went missing. There's over 60-some phone calls made, 30-some before she went missing, 30-some after.
You know what? That's interesting. You're exactly right. And I actually have some different numbers than that, but I think... not that my numbers are right and your numbers are wrong.
Well,
but
I'm probably wrong because I'm normally wrong about a lot of things.
No, you very well could be right. But the numbers I had were like 50 phone calls. So we're not terribly far off. And I had seen like maybe 24 to 26 phone calls before her disappearance, shortly before the disappearance.
Yeah.
And like 24 to 26 phone calls after the disappearance.
Yeah, and I think there's a lot, like I said, I think there's a lot of theories about her going missing to get away. And there has been some sightings. I don't know if they're credible, but there's been some sightings of possibly Maura Murray in Canada. And there's some sightings in Florida of possibly Maura Murray, but she was in a car with Canadian license plates. So I don't know what to think of that, but I do find that stuff pretty interesting. I also find a lot of the psychic readings about this case pretty interesting as well.
Yeah, I enjoyed hearing those as well. They, to me, the ones that I heard were things about more about the hills and the mountains in that area and it being a dark place and, you know, trying to steer people away from being involved in the case, which was,
yeah,
which was not telling of anything at all. I mean, that's a very vague reading. And I do believe that some psychics pretend to be psychic. Not that, not that I know that it actually exists, but
well, some people pretend to be a host of a show.
Yeah. Yeah.
So,
well, and we all saw Pee Wee Herman when he went to try to find his bicycle.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But, well, but regardless, what I'm saying is it was creepy. The, mm-hmm. the psychic stuff that I heard was very creepy, but it was very vague.
Yeah. It's normally pretty vague. The other thing that I thought was interesting was, I believe Renner had, some, location, that some guys from a podcast were going to go visit and they backed out from that visit. I'd like to know that location. I think I'd go up there.
Well, let me ask you this. You have brought up these, this, location to me before. Now, what is supposed to be at the location?
Answers, I guess. I think it was, if you go up there that you'll find her or something. I'm not really for sure, but I know that they got scared and backed out. And that's an area of the country that people just want to be left alone. But I wouldn't mind taking some of my Marine buddies and going up there myself.
Yeah, Captain, let's pack up the Jeep, grab a couple frogmen, and we'll go out into the wilderness. We'll check this place out. We'll get the location. We will find the X on the map, and we'll get it all straightened out.
Well, at the end of the day, what we really hope is that the family has answers. I don't believe that they do have answers, and I hope they get that. And some people might find that talking about some of this stuff is disrespectful, but to me, it's always keeping light on the case, and that pushes the issue. And I think that's everybody that's involved, James Renner, I think the guys at Missing Maura Murray, our show, obviously, we just want to bring light to something and hopefully keep the conversation going so she's not forgotten and we do get answers one day.
Well, not only that, answers for the family, of course, but until you can provide answers for the family, maybe a little more help, you know, from law enforcement, FBI, and people in the area.
Yeah, push the issue a little bit. All right, let's do some recommended reading.
Yep, of course. Just like last week, we have James Renner's new book, True Crime Addict. This is the most thorough book regarding the Maura Murray case, and you can pick it up. It's on pre-order right now. It will be coming out next week, May 24th. And you can pick that up at Amazon. You go to truecrimegarage.com, click on our big, giant, beautiful Amazon banner right there. You support the show. It costs you $0 extra. And you go straight to the Amazon website and you pick up his book and you get it right when it comes out.
Yeah, one of the things that you're going to dig about this book is it's not just about this case, but it's what this case can do to you. And when I got involved in this case, I mean, we all know I'm some cases I just don't get into. This one I dove into. I mean, we're talking about 5 hours a day, sometimes for weeks at a time. This for some reason, this case is just that. So he touches on that a little bit in his book.
And you know what? I've always heard from, you know, many different authors. I never heard this from James, but the thing that I found very interesting, I've heard this from many authors. The last thing that you want to do, the last thing you want to have happen when you're writing a book, when you set out to do it, is that you find yourself becoming a character in the book.
Right.
That at some point, the story has taken you so far into it that mm-hmm. you have to write about yourself. Now, that's what he had to do in this book. So that, to me, is fascinating. So go to our website, truecrimegarage.com, and pick that up today.
Again, thanks to everybody that's involved in the True Crime Army, not just on our show, but all the other shows. Much love to you guys.
Yep. Be good to each other. We'll see you next week. And until then, don't litter.